All this is a joint work with Frédéric Mongold from Angers. Okay. So also I should say this is say my most recent work, somehow related to Gromov-Witten theory. I should say it's not that much on Gromov-Witten theory, but say rather on what to do with some this Gromov-Witten invariant sort of. And some nice consequence of this existence of Gromov-Witten invariant was observed by Collard in the 90s. So let me first recall this same theorem of Collard. So the theorem is the following, that if you take, consider smooth projective uniruled manifold over the complex number, then actually there is some relevant non-trivial Gromov-Witten invariant, which is responsible for the manifold to be uniruled. So let's say, let me recall this, so let's X be, say, smooth projective uniruled manifold.
By the way, that's Cora and myself.
Okay. Uniruled manifold so defined over C. Okay, so then so there is some non-trivial mixed Gromov-Witten invariant. So then there exists some homology class, some integer k, and say ample divisors h1, hk, ample divisor. Such that the following Gromov-Witten invariant doesn't vanish. So I will explain what does it count. So some mixed Gromov-Witten invariant sometimes denoted like this, say points h1, hk, let's say, doesn't vanish.
Okay, it's going to be hard with this microphone, which is broken. Okay.
So conversely, of course, if you have such a non-trivial Gromov-Witten invariant, you know that the manifold is uniruled. So, because it produces for you, through every point, a rational curve, which by definition means it's uniruled. So what does this Gromov-Witten invariant count? So it's actually enumerative in this situation of Collard. So what does it count? Well, point K, say, is an element in the moduli space of stable curve, genus zero stable curve. So this is with k plus 1 mark point. Okay. So let's say you have point z0 zk in CP1, the Riemann sphere. Well, such that precisely this Riemann sphere together with this point represent this representative point k in this, say, I assume I'm in the main stratum of this moduli space of stable gene zero stable curve. So I just have an irreducible curve with k plus 1 points here with fixed conformal structure. And then, then this Gromov-Witten invariance, so say you have a point, so this point here is say a point x in the manifold x. And then this Gromov-Witten invariance, so on k, well say x h1 hk counts the number of maps u from this Riemann sphere to the projective manifold x such that, well, first of all, it pushes the fundamental class of CP1 to this fixed homology class. So we are counting rational curve in this homology class A. And it maps the point Z0 to this point X, which we fix. And it maps the point Zi to the divisor Hi. So for every I. So this is precisely what this counts. So it's indeed enumerative. Just count this number of maps. So yeah, of course, this map, this number of maps is designed to be finite, and you count the cardinality. So this prescribes the integer k. So this set of moduli space of rational curve in this class is given by the Riemann-Rohr formula. So dimension of the moduli space is this. If n is dimension of, say, n is the complex dimension of x. So this is the dimension of space of maps from Riemann sphere. And these conditions, so to pass through the first condition that Z0 is mapped to x costs n degree of freedom, while the other one costs 1 degree of freedom each. So from this, you see that k is just the Chern number of this A. Okay. Okay. So one nice consequence of this. Well, if you remember that Gromov explained to us that this set of Gromov-Witten invariants perfectly makes sense for symplectic manifolds. So thanks to this result, so you can transpose the theory of uniruled manifold to symplectic manifold. The notion of a uniruled manifold in the symplectic category just makes sense thanks to this. So let me define this. A closed symplectic manifold, say x omega, is said to be uniruled if and only if there exists such a homology class A. Such that, say, the integer k, which is this first Chern number, is non-negative. And this Gromov-Witten invariant point k point, and here let me put omega to the power k, doesn't vanish. So I make few comments on this definition before going on. Yes.
What is the point
Point K is this, so an element in this moduli space. So it is a it is genus zero curve with K plus one with fixed conformal structure. So it's a mixed Gromov-Witten invariant from your point of view. This is one of the comments I am going to do. Indeed. So first of all, maybe to just remind, of course, that symplectic form omega is symplectic, means that d omega, it is closed and non-degenerated. Okay. Second comment I want to do, say here, so with such a symplectic form, you can always perturb it a bit so that it becomes rational. So we may perturb omega such that this cohomology class is rational. And then you may think of this ample divisor in the previous definition as Poincaré dual to some large multiple of omega, and which are Poincaré dual to some large multiple of omega, which would be the Keller form in the previous situation. But of course, well, you don't even need to do this because you can view this Gromov-Witten invariant as integration of the pullback of this form by some evaluation map on the moduli space. Okay, and third remark is related to what you just said, and this was a definition proposed by Yang-Din Huan already out of this result, that exactly you may declare that a symplectic manifold is uniruled if such a Gromov-Witten invariant doesn't vanish, but not only prescribing this form of degree 2k, but any kind of form with total degree 2k. Because then, once you know that this Gromov-Witten invariant doesn't vanish for any kind of form, it sort of produces for you a rational curve for any almost complex structure and any point. But there is some reason for us to restrict ourselves to this more restrictive definition, which still contains a complex projective uniruled manifold, is because we aim to study Lagrangian submanifold. So at some point, I'm going to study Lagrangian submanifold in uniruled symplectic manifold. And when you study Lagrangian submanifold, it's extremely convenient to have, instead of any kind of form, to have the symplectic form. Basically because it has some Poincaré dual disjoint from the Lagrangian submanifold. And since I want to do some symplectic field theory, some splitting, to have a Poincaré dual representative disjoint from Lagrangian submanifold is kind of extremely convenient. So that's why we restrict ourselves to such a notion of. Okay? Okay. Okay, now let me formulate the results. So let's say first theorem, say joint work with Frédéric Mangold, as I said. Joint. So main result would be this one. So let X omega be closed symplectic uniruled six manifold and let L inside X be a closed Lagrangian submanifold. She's diffeomorphic to the suspension of hyperbolic diffeomorphism of the two torus. So I recall what's this. And then the conclusion is that there should be a symplectic disk in this manifold with boundary on L, so that the boundary is non-trivial in rational homology. Then X has a symplectic disk D, such that the boundary sits on this Lagrangian submanifold. And the homology class of this boundary doesn't vanish in the first homology group of L with rational coefficients. Okay, this is the main theorem. So the motivation for us to prove this theorem is the following corollary, which answers the question of Kolar. So which confirms, confirms a guess of Kolar. And the corollary is the following. So let X be, so again I'm going in the category of projective manifold. So let X be a Delpezzo vibration over a curve. So this is a threefold and which is defined over R. Well, and in this Kolar, so assume that the set of real points is orientable. And then the conclusion is that no connected component of this real locus can carry a sol metric, which is quotient of the solvable Lie group. So again, I will recall right now what's this. And no components. No connected components of this real locus can carry a sol metric. So this is one of the geometry, special geometry in dimension 3. Okay, and as I said, this confirms the guess of Kolar. We didn't quite formulate this as a conjecture, but he quite guessed that it should be true. Also for this, I will recall for you, how did Kolar came to such formulate such a guess? So before this, so let me tell you what I mean by hyperbolic diffeomorphism of the two torus. Then what is a sol manifold?
Staff. Can I ask, is that H1 LQ, is that rank 1?
Yes, which I will recall also at some point. In this case, yes, because exactly to, well, if I would put integer coefficient, there would be some torsion. But with rational coefficient, I just kill the torsion, and it becomes just rank 1. Right. Okay. Is there another question? Well, if not, so what is the hyperbolic diffeomorphism of the two torus? Well, for us, hyperbolic diffeomorphism of the two torus T is a diffeomorphism whose action on homology, well, this diffeomorphism phi, says that the induced morphism on homology, first homology of the torus, with real coefficients, has two real eigenvalues, but none of which is of module 1. Modulus different from 1. So you see this first homology group of the torus with real coefficient is just a plane. And this means that this morphism diagonalizes, this endomorphism of this plane diagonalizes with two eigenspaces. And one eigenspace is contracted by phi and the other eigenspace is dilated by phi, since the product of this eigenvalue is plus or minus 1, actually. Okay. Now, of course, then the suspension of such a diffeomorphism, L, is the product, say, T times R. Did I write T or T2? T times R modulo the relation that x, comma T is equivalent to phi of x, comma T plus 1. So this is the suspension, and this has a morphism onto the circle, which is induced by projection on the second factor. Okay. And now another quick definition, what is a Sol manifold? A Sol manifold is a compact quotient of the Lie group Sol. So is a, say, for us, closed compact quotient of the solvable Lie group, which is a semi-direct product of R2 with R. So, not exactly recall what is the law, but it's just semi-direct product. And it's not that hard to figure out what are the quotient, compact quotient of this Lie group. It's actually basically precisely this suspension of hyperbolic diffeomorphism of the two torus, except that there are some of these suspensions which, when you see them as quotient of Sol, have an additional Z2 which acts by isometry. So in addition to these manifolds, you may just see also some Z2 quotient of some of them. So, closed Sol manifolds. Suspensions. N or Z2 quotient well, so you see in this theorem we We only deal with suspension of hyperbolic diffeomorphism of the two torus, but it turns out that for our corollary, we can include all of them because up to branch cover, we can pass. Okay. Reduce the situation to the situation of the theorem. Okay, let me also mention, since there are some symplectic geometers in the audience, let me just mention another corollary of this theorem, which is the following. So if you consider a closed symplectic four-manifold with a Lagrangian two-torus inside, and if you consider Hamiltonian diffeomorphism of this four-manifold, which preserves the two-torus, then it cannot induce a hyperbolic transformation of the two-torus. So let X omega be a closed symplectic four manifold and T be a Lagrangian torus. Now let phi be a Hamiltonian diffeomorphism such that it preserves this Lagrangian torus T. Then the restriction of phi to this torus cannot be hyperbolic in the following in the sense of definition. Okay. Okay. So are there any questions? No, okay. Then I can mention how to prove such a result. So, and the main ingredient of the proof is the symplectic field theory of Elias Berg, Giventhal, and Hofer. Okay. Well. Well, first of all, recall the, this very first situation. This Gromov-Witten invariant, which I mentioned for a uniruled, projective uniruled manifold, can of course be seen as the degree of some evaluation map. And let me introduce, for instance, one space. Say, MA of XH. Which is the set of map U from CP1 to your projective manifold X, such that it pushes forward the fundamental class of CP1 to A, and it maps the point ZI into this divisor HI, the ample divisor, for every I between 1 and K. So this is now a nice threefold, and it comes with some evaluation map from XH onto X, and which takes such a map U and evaluates it at the point Z0. So I have some evaluation map, and of course, the Gromov-Witten invariant point K plus. Point K, point H, X, A is the degree of this evaluation map. Well, of course, now for a symplectic manifold, so I was just about to mention this. Now, what you do is you pick, you do the same for a generic almost complex structure J. So choose here a generic almost complex structure. And since anyway I'm concerned with six manifolds, so you know that symplectic six manifolds are semi-positive, say. So then you know from just index computation that this moduli space is of the expected dimension for a generic almost complex structure. And again, the dimension is first chain class x against A plus the dimension here, which is 3. Well, here now it becomes only a real dimension is twice this, of course. Okay? Is that answer? Does this answer? And then this evaluation map is, say, a pseudo cycle in the language of Magdoff Salomon. Well, in a second, I won't even need any more to compactify, since I will reduce dimension. So I'll reduce here, take a loop here, and reduce to one dimensional. So I do not even need to compactify, but turns out. Okay, but in any case, for six manifolds, I can compactify without any issue. Now, in this first situation of, say, Collard and Juan, so you have this homology class is, so you take now any kind of projective manifold of any dimension, but the homology class you take, so say fix some projective embedding, and the homology class A is actually the lowest degree homology class for which it is uniruled by a curve of this degree. And because of this lowest degree, still there is no problem even if you want to compactify it. So, okay, since I guess this was your question. Okay, so now, for such a symplectic manifold, so you just repeat the procedure by just for a generic almost complex structure, and then you have this moduli space. Okay. Because, of course, Gromov explained that you don't really need a complex structure of algebraic structure to have this Gromov-Witten invariant. It perfectly makes sense if you deform the complex structure into an almost complex structure 1, that is within the realm of complex structure of the tangent bundle rather than just complex structure on the manifold. And actually, it will be crucial here that even if you start as in the first corollary, even if you start with some projective manifold, it will be crucial for us that we can deform the complex structure within some which are no more integrable, so no more. And this comes out of the symplectic field theory, which I will mention. Okay. Okay, now the second thing we do is the following. Say we fix gamma in X, say a loop, an embedded loop. And then say, can denote by, let me denote by MAJ gamma, which is just the inverse image of this loop gamma. So that now this is perfectly compact and one dimensional. And smooth. And this is basically compact because all singular curves, say reducible curves or stuff like this, come in complex codimension 1. So that a generic loop, say, or for a generic almost complex structure, you just avoid this broken situation, as I said. So if you reduce over a loop, you just see a smooth, compact, one-dimensional manifold. And it's also crucial for us, sort of, not to restrict, say, take a generic point and see finitely many curves which you count, but rather take such a loop and see kind of covering, or I'll say a map between one-dimensional manifold, this, onto the loop, the circle, which has non-trivial degree. So note the evaluation map, let me still denote it by evaluation, from MAJ CH gamma onto gamma. So again, just a restriction of the evaluation map of before, has non-trivial degree. And these are just compact one-dimensional manifolds now. Okay. Well. Okay, now the third thing, of course, it has already been mentioned. The first cohomology group with rational coefficients of such suspension of a hyperbolic diffeomorphism of the two torus turns out to be just isomorphic to be one-dimensional, say. And it's generated by sections of the fibration. Section of the fibration, of course, L being the suspension of a hyperbolic diffeomorphism of the two torus. As I said, it fibers over the circle, with the fiber being torus, T2, and monodromy being my hyperbolic diffeomorphism. Okay? So now if you take a section of such fibration, you get a loop in L, which is just generates this first cohomology group. There would be class in the fiber sometimes, but which are torsion, so they are killed by these rational coefficients. And of course, now I will choose the loop gamma to sit inside L, this Lagrangian submanifold, and exactly such that it generates this first cohomology group. So say gamma, my loop gamma is precisely the image of such a section. Take gamma with the image of such a section. Well, the only important thing is that it generates this H1. Okay, now comes the key ingredient, which is the symplectic field theory. So recall first this procedure of Caporazzo and Harris to break sort of Gromov-Witten invariant into pieces and say basically compute. So this theory of relative invariance. So picture is the following. Say, assume you have H, say X, some complex projective manifold, say for instance. Projective manifold, and you have H, which is say a divisor, say a smooth divisor. Then out of this, you can cook out the trivial deformation of X, so X times C over C, and then you can blow up this divisor over the origin, so say, blow up this H times 0 in this product X times C. And then you get a non-trivial deformation Y over C, such that the fibers YT are isomorphic to the manifold X for non-zero. And y0, the fiber y0 is reducible. And one irreducible component is just x. And the other irreducible component is the projectivization of, say, O plus the normal bundle of H in X. So I guess this is extremely familiar to you. So you have this central fiber as two irreducible components, which you may think of being close to H, and this is this ruled manifold, and one which is just X, and it intersects at H, sort of. So since you have this deformation, you have nearby fibers YT, which are just isomorphic to X. And what you can do is to push this nearby fiber to the central fiber, and then figure out what happens to these rational curves, which are counted by this Gromov-Witten invariant. So in the limit, they just split into reducible curves, some in the X, some in this ruled manifold, and then in good situation, you can even compute Gromov-Witten invariant. Okay. Okay, now comes this symplectic field theory of Eliasberg, Giesenthal, and Hofer. And in a sense, it's a kind of great generalization of this procedure. So in my situation here, it would tell you to do the following. So say you start with this almost complex structure, or even the complex one given by this projective structure of complex projective manifold. And then you deform it during a path JT until it converges to some kind of singular one, J infinity. And during this deformation of the Solmos complex structure, you should think of X as being with this JT. And in the limit, with J infinity, you should think of X precisely also with two different components, where X infinity having two different components. One component is the cotangent bundle of this Lagrangian submanifold, and the other component is the complement of this Lagrangian submanifold. So I can tell you more on this. Actually, there is. Okay, let me erase this. Let me tell you more. So maybe the beginning of is a theorem of Alan Weinstein, which I can recall. If you consider any, say, L closed Lagrangian submanifold in a symplectic manifold X omega, then the neighborhood of this is always standard, and actually symplectomorphic to a neighborhood of the zero section in cotangent bundle. So first of all, the normal bundle of L is isomorphic to cotangent bundle, but even a neighborhood of the Lagrangian is just standard. standard. So then there exists V neighborhood of L in X and W neighborhood of the zero section in the cotangent bundle of L, and a diffeomorphism phi from V to W, diffeomorphism such that the image of L is the zero section, and the pullback of the canonical symplectic form of the cotangent bundle, so d lambda, exterior derivative of this Liouville 1 form, is just omega. So phi is symplectomorphism. So you see here, if you start from the manifold X with some Lagrangian submanifold L, this actually cotangent bundle part is in fact just a neighborhood. Say this Weinstein neighborhood V given by this theorem V. And this complement of, so this is rather V, say. And this X minus L is rather X minus V. But with this fancy almost complex structure J infinity, which is given by the symplectic field theory. So after some stretching procedure, which is very much like this picture of Caporazzo and Harris. Okay. So you may again think this, in the limit, the manifold as having two pieces. So one is this X minus L, and one is this cotangent bundle of L. And the point here for this procedure to work is just that the boundary of this neighborhood is a so-called contact type hypersurface, so which is enough for this to work. So boundary of V is a contact type hypersurface . So this is a contact manifold. And the fact that this boundary of V is a contact type hypersurface is enough for symplectic field theory to produce this picture of Caporazzo and Harris, basically, to split the manifold in two. And again, when you have rational curves in your symplectic manifold, which are counted by some Gromov eta invariant, then you may use this process to split the manifold in two, and then rational curve split, as you will see in a second, and you may, in good situation, just, for instance, compute Gromov-Witten invariant. Well, for example, if H in CPN is a smooth quadric, then the two procedures coincide, basically. Coincide, say, actually, the complement of this quadric surface turns out to be, say, or at least diffeomorphic to the cotangent bundle of RPN, which is Lagrangian in CPN. And the complement of this Lagrangian, well, say, turns out to be isomorphic, diffeomorphic to say normal bundle of H in CPN, sort of. It's rather isomorphic to a disk bundle and not the full line bundle. But after the stretching the neck procedure, as I said, you leave the realm of integrable structure, and what you get is actually the full, when it's split, full line bundle. Okay. Okay, now, Now what happens, coming back to this situation, so I have this Lagrangian submanifold in my uniruled symplectic manifold X omega. So when I do the splitting for, use the splitting procedure given by symplectic field theory, so I have this moduli space M A say G infinity of X, H and gamma. This one-dimensional compact manifold. Well, when the almost complex structure converges to the singular one, J infinity, all irreducible rational curves which were counted by this become reducible, of course, with some component in this cotangent bundle of L parts and some components in the complement. So it's made of reducible curves. And for all these curves, of course, there is a special mark point Z0. So for all of these curves, some special irreducible component, which is the one which contains the point Z0. Reducible with one component C, say CC0, which contains the mark point Z0. So these are reducible curves, of course. So the source. So the irreducible CP1 has split now into some nodal genus zero curve, but still it has mark point on it. Z1, Z2, Z3, Zk. The conformal structure didn't change, actually, if you stabilize the curve. And so one irreducible component, which I denote by CZ0, contains the mark point Z0. Okay. And this one, of course, this component CZ0 is mapped into the cotangent bundle part, since Z0 is mapped by U to L, or even gamma in L, which is included in cotangent bundle part. So what we can do is to forget all of the components except this one which contains Z0. Since we are interested in the evaluation map, we can just forget all remaining components and just keep in mind what is this component CZ0, since we are going to evaluate at Z0, point Z0. So say, let us denote, say, M A G0, J infinity, of, say, T star L H gamma to be the set of such components C, Z0 with the map U restricted to this component C, Z0. So there is some forgetful map from this moduli space here of broken curve in X in this moduli space in cotangent bundle, which forgets all irreducible components except the one which contains CZ0. Of course. And here you have still this evaluation map into gamma. And likewise, you have here the evaluation map, which CZ0 and this map, say, called U0, you evaluate at the point U0. So you have a commutative diagram like this. Okay. So now what you have to do is to understand what are these components CZ0, exactly, what are these maps. And this is also given by symplectic field theory, but you have to work a little bit.
Sorry, I don't understand the A. I mean, the A, the degree of the map.
Yeah, A no more makes sense. So it's just here you should understand this really as just arriving. Well, it's become more clear now in a few minutes, but these are meant to be just restrictions of maps from here. So here, A perfectly makes sense, right? It's the cohomology class of X.
But then if it's constant, for example, on the curve C0, then it's constant map?
Or it cannot be constant on C0. Okay. Well, it's become more clear. So I will explain right now. I will explain what are these maps, what they have to be. So I have to tell you more on symplectic field theory to tell you what are these maps. Okay. And I'll say at this point we precisely assume that there is no symplectic disk on our manifold with non-trivial boundary on Lagrange-Johnson manifold, non-trivial in homology class. So assume that there is no disk. No. Such that the boundary of the disk lies on L and the homology class of this doesn't vanish. Okay, we assume this. If there is one, we are done, since in any case we claim that there is one. There should be one. But if there is no, then we can quite figure out what are these curves. So then there are two possibilities, actually. So either CZ0 is a twice functor Riemann sphere, or it is Riemann sphere with K functor Z1, ZK. With precisely the k-functors z1, zk. And again, such that this Riemann sphere with the mark point c0 and this functor z1, zk precisely realize the class, the representative which we have chosen in the moduli space of k plus 1 points. So not only this, well, let's put us in the second situation. Not only this, but then the map also. So I have this target space is this cotangent bundle with zero section here. And here I have cotangent bundle of L. At the source, I have this Riemann sphere, punctured Riemann sphere with K puncture. And what you know is that this map is proper. So in this cotangent bundle, there is this almost complex structure J infinity. And this map has to be proper. So there are punctures here. Punctures are mapped to infinity. And there is one mark point here on the zero section, Z0. So U0 is a proper map. Proper J infinity holomorphic map. So you see, for instance, the constant map is not proper. So. Oh. And the behavior near the puncture, and this is also prescribed by symplectic field theory, the behavior near the puncture is that it has to converge to some closed orbit of the geodesic flow. U0 converges to some close orbit of the geodesic flow. F- for a sole Riemannian metric which we put on L, well, suitably chosen actually. So we choose some sole Riemannian metric such that the volume of the fibers are quite small with respect to the length of the base. And in this situation, we can say more than this. We can say that these orbit of the geodesic flow, so they lift just geodesic which are in fibers of this torus fibration. Say which lifts geodesics in fiber. Of L over. Okay. Okay, so now I'm almost done. So, because all these moduli space turns out to be compact, so both these moduli space are just compact moduli space. This moduli space of curves with two punctures or with k punctures but fixed conformal structure, which leads to this. And now you can just play the following game. You have this evaluation map. So T star L, well, to gamma, which you may even project onto the base of this vibration of L. So here you have some evaluation map with non-trivial degree. But on the other hand, precisely if you project on this base, you see that all such curves, u0, if you compose with this projection, say projection pi from cotangent bundle to R over Z, the composition of the map u0 with pi extends at the puncture to a map of the whole CP1 into R over Z, but we fixed image of Z1, Zk. Because since these are these go to geodesic into some fibers, when you project the fiber, it is just always a point in this space, circle base. And so this evaluation map, which is evaluation map at Z0, which is supposed to have non-trivial degree, it is homotopic to the evaluation map at one of these points, which has a trivial degree because it's constant. So evaluation at Z0 is homotopic to evaluation at Z1, which has trivial degree, which is constant. And this is the contradiction. Okay, thank you very much.